We're in East Germany, in Stralsund, almost to the border to Poland, former GDR. I'm trying to recapture a view of an old postcard of the city of Stralsund. I try to find images that I find interesting, and then I work my way up from those images. The actual image that I get from the lab the next day, that's only half of the process. I work on the images a lot afterwards. I draw in them, I enhance them, and I construct them to a degree that's not necessarily linked to actuality anymore. It's more like an idealized image, like maybe the way postcards used to work. Sometimes I work on the images just a week, sometimes it takes months. I'm not sure how it's gonna work out today, but the view is good, there's no fog, and it's almost as I expected it. That's the reference. It's an old photograph of Stralsund back in GDR times, circa 1970. I like it because it's very sparsely lit, it's very minimal. You still have those Gothic cathedrals in the background, but then in the front you have functional buildings, basic shapes, and then it's very basic. Image cuts in half, you have sky, and then you have this foreground. I like the way it becomes very abstract. Final image might look much different from this, but I kind of like the basic composition of it. There's maybe like 15 light sources, and today it's not the case anymore. It's actually overlit because it's UNESCO World Heritage, and you can already see that all the spots are on the domes. Some of the warehouses have been torn down, and they also constructed this new gallery type aquarium over that white spot, so I would definitely take that out because that's too modern, too white. I saw this place by accident because it's a mural in the station of Stralsund in East Germany. It had a very nostalgic German feeling about an old-time illustration of Rügen. It is a very imprecise image, open to your imagination. It doesn't give away all the facts. Maps just give you an idea of a place. They're like an illustration, but they're clearly the opposite of a precise photograph. This is a photograph of the mural in Stralsund. I took out the names and descriptions and turned it into an even more nondescript image. It was painted in 1936, but to me it stands more for the East German social realist era and the glorification of the farmer's state. I took a photograph of the real island when I was there, and it didn't work out to me. It was too flat and we couldn't get high up enough. And of course it looks very different to the illustration, and so I thought the illustration is just another level of abstracting it. It lifts you to another layer that is not necessarily linked to realism, and it opens up your own world or your own myth-making. It works fine with an abstract image like June Lake, for example. It's called Above June Lake and it shows the ski resort in the Sierras. We were skiing and I saw this image at the diner and I was instantly struck by it for its abstract qualities, because it could be an abstract scribble, but it could also be a piece of land art, much more chaotic than just a pure line. Most of the ski resorts, at least in the Sierras, are below tree line, so they have to cut out the slopes and basically create this scribble. And this was also one of the photographs that I couldn't take myself because it's clearly an aerial photograph. Still, though, very abstract, and it's very precise, like a satellite photograph. On the other hand, you have Rügen, which is really just like a very few brush strokes and very simple. Just gives you an illusion or an idea of how it could look, so it's very imprecise. This is a pass in Italy next to the Swiss border. I've been to that pass many times, and then all of a sudden, at one point, I saw postcards of that pass, and I was just struck by the scribble of the serpentines. It's really just like an abstract gesture. The Italian engineers made the scribble for me in the image. I bought all the postcards they had to determine if the vantage point is valid enough. The more images that are taken from one spot, the more reason for me to take another photograph in a way. Those are some of the postcards. You can always see the serpentines. This one is pretty close to where I was. That's a very vintage one. They would also, just to make it more dramatic, paint in white snow, which I also did on this one because there wasn't enough snow and I want to have those fields of white snow, so I just drew them in myself. As a reference to the postcards, I thought, well, try to use a process that is maybe linked to like offset printing and even old color photography. It's called tricolor photography. Take three black and white exposures with three different filters, red, blue, and green. And then you sandwich those three negatives together. The end result is a color photograph. But since you're sandwiching three photographs together, they don't register evenly. So there's a lot of irregularities. And then you also have the clouds or anything that moves will create a different color. Because there's time between the exposures. So this cloud was only recorded by one exposure. That's why it turns pink, for example. Or one cloud was only recorded by another exposure. That's why it turns yellow. Photography used to be like alchemy back in the 19th century. It was a medium of the few, and now it has turned into a mass medium. Maybe it's reactionary to turn backwards and to try to establish artistry again, but it's also the most interesting part of the process and not just like the black box, like a digital camera. I need to treat each photo individually to determine the right size or scale for it. Some of the works might be huge vistas, so I hang them low so you can actually look downwards to it and it might work as a map, or you can inspect every detail. It needs to be big enough that you can actually get lost in one corner without getting distracted by the other corner. I don't do serial work. I think every piece needs its own presentation and scale. I turn a finished photograph almost back into a scribble again. Usually a photograph is very precise, very rigorous, and it's an end product. And I like to use the end product and turn it into an unfinished state again. I think it's fine to combine photography and drawing, for example, or alter photographs and bring in fictional elements. Just not be satisfied with photography as a finished image or a super realistic medium. I like the idea of using the computer to actually bring in imperfections or to turn a photograph, a finished image, into a more open-ended image so that it's not too precise or so overdetermined. The computer has opened up much more possibilities, so you can really go into the photograph today, which was hard to do in the early 20th century. The real beginning was when I came to California, because I didn't come here for its scenic beauty. I came here for the artists that were teaching at UCLA, and I thought the art they were doing was exactly the art that I liked. I'm always kind of critical and think the work is not good enough. And you are always just this poor photographer whose art is usually considered like a side product. It's not like the real art, it's more some sort of inferior art. At least that's how it is in Germany. And maybe in the US, photography is definitely more established because photography grew together with the discovery of the American West. There's a photograph by Watkins, it's called The Best General View, and I thought this was perfect to take a photograph from Glacier Point in Yosemite, which is the most popular spot towards Half Dome, which is the most photographed mountain probably in America, and name it The Best General View. I like the stage quality. It wasn't a perfect day when I took the photograph. It was overcast a little bit, and I didn't mind. It's just a starting point. I drew in the entire background with the blue sky and the clouds, and I brought in those bushes to bring in some foreground, background space. So in the end, except for Half Dome, the image is not the way it looked when I took the picture. That's an image near Santa Clarita, on the outskirts of Los Angeles.
it shows the remains of the St. Francis Dam. St. Francis Dam was a failure. Just by researching, we learn about Mulholland and the fact that he resigned after the failure of the dam. Failure usually is the side that nobody wants to mention, nobody wants to point out, and that's the hidden side or the subcontext in a way.
We're standing on the dam. This is the vista towards the old former lake that was drained when the dam collapsed. Today it's back to its old nature. And I'm just recording basically like a straight photograph of the former lake or the valley. I'm using the photograph as a script. But I was more interested in the abstract qualities when I was researching the dam. And I looked at documents from the day it collapsed in 29. The picture was almost cut in half. You would see a representational mountain landscape on the top, and then you would see a drained lake at the bottom. And the drained lake was basically just like an abstract piece, like figures and forms and lines. The idea was to have a representational upper part and you create an abstract lower part and you mix the two together. I'm always more interested in the mixture of those two, which is kind of hard to combine abstraction and representation in one image. I start with a basic drawing and then I continue to draw into it and turn it more and more into a scribble that has hundreds of layers of dots, like a pointer list image. One of the reasons to come out here to Los Angeles, because it's not only exotic in a certain way, but you understand the culture because you grow up with America. You get a fresh light, you get a new landscape, and that landscape is still significant. It has a great meaning, and it's the end of American pioneerism. It's the end of the American West, and from a German aspect, it's also the end of the world.
Educational resources, please visit us online at pbs.org. Art 21, Art in the 21st Century, is available on Blu-ray and DVD. The companion book is also available. To order, visit us online at shoppbs.org or call PBS Home Video at 1-800-PLAY-PBS.